And the fourth will be a combination where we can have equity plus debt plus preference. Right. Now, I also want to teach you this. When you buy an equity share or you buy a preference share, the return that is paid, return on a share paid by the company, is called dividend. On the other hand, when you buy the return on a debt instrument, or when you buy a debenture or a bond, or when you're giving a long-term loan to a company, the return that is paid on it is called interest. Now we all have to know that this payment of interest is a statutory obligation. Statutory obligation from which the company can never escape. In 1 year, if the company is going to default with respect to payment of dividend, it is enough for the company to be taken to court, whereby a decree can be obtained and the company can be taken up for liquidation on 1 year. But payment of dividend is not a statutory obligation. There is no legal obligation binding on the company to pay dividend to the shareholders. Whether they are preference or equity, we have to understand payment of dividend is not a statutory obligation. One more thing that we have to notice, when we buy a debt instrument or a preference share, the return is fixed. So when we are talking about fixed return securities, fixed return bearing securities, it will include debt instruments plus preference shares. Whereas, with respect to the equity shares, we have to understand that they are not coming under the category of fixed return bearing securities. The company will decide year after year what should be the amount that need to be paid as dividend to the equity shareholders. So it is a decision that is taken by the board after some calculations are done, which I'll be showing you shortly. So please understand, return on a share is called dividend and it is not a statutory obligation. There is no statutory obligation on the part of the company to pay this dividend to the shareholders. Whereas return on debt, which is called interest, is a statutory obligation from which the company can never escape. Right. Now, we have to understand why companies desire to have these fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure. Why is it that they are not satisfied just with having equity in the capital structure? What is the need for them to employ debt or fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure? So let's see. Why companies employ fixed return bearing securities in capital structure? What is the need to have these fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure? When companies employ fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure, like debt or preference, it helps them to magnify or increase the EPS. So the reason is, helps in increasing, or I will call it as, helps in maximizing EPS. What is this EPS? This EPS is to be expanded as earnings per share. I will be teaching you shortly how to calculate this earnings per share. This earnings per share becomes the basis for decision taken by the board of directors with respect to equity dividend that need to be paid to the equity shareholders. We will be seeing that soon. So, why companies employ fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure? They want to employ fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure because it helps them in maximizing this EPS. And this concept in finance is called as trading on equity, or it is called as financial leverage. So when the company has fixed return bearing securities like debt and preference shares in the capital structure, we will say that company is a levered company, and when a company has no debt or preference shares in the capital structure, we will call it as an unlevered company. Just take how we apply, you know, a lever to reduce the efforts that we have to apply. Just take how we apply, use a lever to reduce the efforts we have to apply. Companies make use of this concept of trading on equity to help them to maximize the EPS. We will do a numerical example with the help of which it will become clear that whenever companies have debt in the capital structure or preference in the capital structure, it helps them to maximize the EPS. And by maximizing the EPS, they are in a position to declare higher dividends. When dividends are high, naturally the market price is high, and when market price is high, the value of the firm is also increased. So it's a vicious circle. Right, let's continue. Let us assume there are three companies which are identical in every respect except for their capital structure. Let me assume the EBIT for each company is rupees 4 lakhs, 4 lakhs, 4 lakhs. Right? And let's see what is the amount of debt that these companies have employed. Let me assume A company has no debt, but this company has debt of rupees 4 lakhs and C company also has no debt. Next, 13% preference. This 10% debt means this company is paying interest on debt at the rate of 10%. So if it is 10% or 4 lakh, the amount of interest that this company will be paying will be 40,000 per year. Now 13% preference, here also no. Here no preference, here no preference, but let me assume here the preference is 4 lakhs. And last but not the least, the equity share capital, let me assume, has a par value or face value. Equity shares have a par value of rupees 100. And the amount employed is 10 lakhs. Here it will be 6 lakhs and it is 6 lakhs. So I think we all understand total capital employed in all these three companies. In all these three companies is the same. Here also it is 10 lakhs, here it is 10 lakhs, and here it is 10 lakhs. So they are identical in every respect except for that capital structure. Alright, assuming tax at 50%, let us calculate. Let's do it. Statement showing calculation of EPS. Let us calculate the EPS, which is called as the earnings per share. Statement showing calculation of EPS. EPS stands for earnings per share. So we have got three companies. What are the three companies? A, B, and C. A has only equity. This has got equity and debt. And this has got equity and preference. So let's start with the EBIT. EBIT is 4 lakhs. 4 lakhs. 4 lakhs. Less interest at 10%. I have to pay interest only if I have raised money through the issue of debt. Here, it is an all equity, but here we have equity and debt. What is the amount of debt that I have raised? 4 lakhs, on which I have to pay interest at 10%. So it will be 40,000, and here again no debt. So what is my earnings after interest and tax? It is 4 lakhs, 3 lakhs 60,000, and here it is again 4 lakhs. Next, less tax at 50%. So what is my tax at 50%? 2 lakhs will go off as tax, 1 lakh 80,000 will go off. See, because of employing debt, I have been able to reduce the amount of tax, and here it is. Now, this gives me my earnings after tax. It is 2 lakhs, 1 lakh 80,000, and here again 2 lakhs. Now the next thing that I have to deduct will be less preference dividend. If you remember, I have taught you that first dividend will be paid to the preference shareholders, and only then the board will decide what will be the amount of dividend it wants to declare to the equity shareholders. Preference dividend is paid at 13%. We have no preference shares, so no preference dividend payable. Here also we need not pay, but here we have raised how much? We have raised 4 lakhs at the rate of 13%. So 4 into 13 will be 13 into 4 will be 52,000 rupees I will have to pay as preference dividend. So that tells me what are my earnings available for equity shareholders. What are my earnings that are available? Here it is 2 lakhs in case of A. Here it is 1,80,000 and here it is 1,48,000. Now let's see how many shares each of these companies has issued. So number of shares outstanding. Number of shares outstanding means number of shares issued by the company. This company has raised 10 lakhs, and the par value of one share is 100. So number of shares will be 10,000. So 10,000 shares. Whereas here, this company has raised only 6 lakhs, the par value is 100 rupees, so its number of shares will be 6,000. Likewise, this company has raised only 6 lakhs through the issue of equity, par value is 100, so it will be here also 6,000 shares. Therefore, we can very easily calculate the EPS. EPS will be earnings which is available for equity shareholders divided by the number of equity shares. So 2 lakhs divided by 10,000 will give me rupees 20. Whereas here it will be rupees 6 lakhs divided by 6. So it will be rupees 100, and here also it will be rupees, here it will be 1,48,000 divided by 6 lakhs. So here it will be, here it is going to be 1,80,000 divided, here it will be 6,000 shares. So it will be 1,80,000 divided by, it will be 30 rupees, and here it will be 148 divided by 6. So 24.66. Well, it will be rupees 24.67. So I prove that when a company has got debt in the capital structure, it will have the maximum EPS. Likewise, even when it has preference, it is able to have a higher EPS than when it has only debt. How is it? When debt is there in the capital structure, the company is getting a maximum EPS. Two reasons can be given for that. First reason is, on the amount paid as interest, the company does not pay income tax. So it has got tax exemption on the sum amount paid as tax. Secondly, all companies pay interest at a much lesser rate when compared to the rate at which dividends are paid or equity is paid. That is why we will find when a firm has got debt in the capital structure, it is able to get the maximum EPS. So this concept, as I told you, is called as trading on equity or financial leverage. So what is trading on equity? Inclusion of fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure so as to help the company to maximize its EPS. There's another concept that we have to learn, which is called optimum capital structure. Optimal or optimum capital structure. Optimum capital structure. This optimum or optimal capital structure will tell you what should be the combination of debt and equity in the capital structure. So as to maximize EPS. And when this optimal capital structure is reached, we have to understand EPS will be at its maximum. Since EPS is high, DPS will also high. Since dividends per share is high, market price of the share will also be high. Since market price of the share is high, value of the firm will also be high. Value of the firm is equal to market price of one share into number of shares outstanding. Number of shares outstanding is the company. Okay, there's one more concept. I think we will see that. And that concept is called indifference point. I have taught you that depending upon the capital structure, depending upon the debt equity combination that you have in the capital structure, your EPS will keep fluctuating or it will keep changing. If you have debt, EPS is highest. If you have no debt, EPS is lowest. Now I am going to teach you a concept which is called indifference point, which helps you in calculating the EPS, wherein it tells you what is your EPS, wherein irrespective of your capital structure, EPS remains constant. I repeat again, indifference point refers to, I didn't tell you this, that level of EBIT, wherein irrespective of your capital structure, EPS remains constant. Whatever may be your capital structure, finally when you try to arrive at your EPS will remain the same. That is called as the indifference point. So indifference point actually refers to that level of EBIT, wherein irrespective of your capital structure, whether you it's a levered firm or an unlevered firm, your EPS remains constant. Okay, so what is indifference point? It refers to that level of EBIT wherein irrespective of the capital structure, our EPS remains constant. But earlier I taught you that if it is a levered firm which includes debt, EPS will be high. Since EPS is high, dividends payable by the company will also be high. Since DPS is high, EPS is high, when EPS is high, value of the firm will also be increased. How do we calculate the value of the firm? Value of the firm is equal to market price of one share into number of shares outstanding. Number of shares outstanding means number of shares issued by the company. Next, in case of an unlevered firm, unlevered firm does not employ fixed return bearing securities. It may not have debt in the capital structure. As a result, EPS will be low. When EPS is low, naturally DPS, dividends payable by the company, will be low. When dividends are low, people are not happy. They want to sell off their shares. Only many people will come forward to sell their shares. So many shares are available in the market. As a result, the market price will come down. And since market price is coming down, the value of the firm will also reduce. But in case of this indifference point, whether it is a levered firm or an unlevered firm, okay, we will find this EPS will remain constant. So indifference point refers to that level of EBIT wherein irrespective of the capital structure, EPS will remain constant. So in today's class, we saw the concept of capital structure, We saw what are the patterns of capital structure. I define capital structure as the makeup of a firm's total capitalization. Then I told you there are four patterns of capital structure. Then I taught you the concept of trading on equity or financial leverage, which I repeat is inclusion of fixed return bearing securities in the capital structure in order to help the company to maximize the EPS. Remember, on debt we pay interest from which the company can never escape. It is a statutory obligation. On shares we pay dividend, which is not a statutory obligation. It is left to the discretion of the board of directors to decide whether they like to pay dividends or not. Then I taught you the concept of optimal capital structure. Optimal capital structure refers to that combination of debt and equity where your EPS is high. Goes without saying, when your EPS is high, your EPS is high. When your EPS is high, your NPS is high. When your NPS is high, value of the firm is also high. And last, we saw this concept of financial because of this concept of indifference point, where I defined it as that level of EBIT, wherein irrespective of the capital structure, your EPS will remain. Thank you very much. In tomorrow's class, I will teach you the concept of cost of capital.